formerly a Danish librarian, now turned vendor side. I am part of the Summon development team. Summon is a web scale discovery, which is partly what I'll be talking about. You're welcome to throw rotten tomatoes on at me if I'm getting too commercial. I'm doing my best not to be, but it is a commercial company I work for, so sometimes you get sort of biased. But I'll do my best. And I'll talk about data management and how to make data discoverable. So this is a very different approach from the former speakers. I'm going to look at the uses of data, the uses of content, not so much data, but all kinds of content, and the needs of these users, and what has so far been done to try to help them. And I think a very big company that everybody know will feature predominantly in my talk. First of all, I'll sort of go the same way as Jeff did, talking a little bit about the past. This is how we normally think of libraries, repositories of knowledge. We think of them like they're, this is still how we view them. They're still physical. If you Google library, you'll have a physical picture. You'll have loads of books, you'll have physical buildings. It won't be the vast amount of information that's on the net. What's more scary, can you recognize this? The first one, this one, is the long hall in Trinity College Library, where I accidentally did my training. This is the library of the future. This is the Star Wars library. So this is how some of our foremost science fiction writers or animators have visualized the library of the future, which I think is scary because it's still shelves, it's still physical, it's still things that looks like you can take books. Actually, if you remember that scene when they are in the library, they're actually taking something that looks like volumes out. They haven't moved. They're still thinking of books and data and as physical things. And I'm afraid very many of us, especially us coming from the library side, and as I do, we do still think of libraries as a very physical thing. The ones using our libraries don't, well, they don't use our libraries. And that is one of the problems. They use Google. They don't ask questions. They go whichever way they want to go. And a lot of them, I mean, most of you have read the cyber report, I guess. And a lot of them are not particularly competent in using the web. They just use it as we used a phone book when we were younger. It's not a sophisticated tool. We don't know. They don't know anything about the semantic web. They hardly know how to annotate, how to make citations. They're not necessarily as brilliant as some reports will make us think. They're just users of various creeds. But they know a small pool of quality resources, and they usually stick to them. I remember one time we did a research in Denmark on what people used, and one of the shocking things was that most people in one particular university, everybody was using JSTOR for research, and it's just because they had some good professor telling them. When eventually these young people go to the library and say, okay, there is a library website, I guess this is the right place to go, they very often get to a login page. And everybody who's been standing on a login page not having a password or not having having the right credentials, you get discouraged very, very quickly. And remember, these people, they are the researchers of the future. Or they just get, this is my old library, they just get a long list of resources which is as incomprehensible as the locked pages. So of course they go here, which is fine. You can get a lot of information in Google. I think we all know that. The problem is just that some of the information that we know is there is only partly indexed. And we don't know which part is indexed, and we don't know what we're giving them. Some library catalogs are there, maybe not their own library, but they might find something else. some license material. They might hit it or they might not hit it. Institutional repositories, yes, of course, but can they find them? Data sets, yes, there is some data sets indexed. I found them. And some images. It's all wonderful data, but is it good enough? Is it the way we want research of the future to be managed? Because these guys who's out there using Google, they're the ones who are going to be the ones that Michael talked about, the ones making the data sets, the one making the research, writing the articles. And it would be, I think personally, but then of course my profession makes me very biased, it would be rather nice if they also used peer-reviewed material and they knew how to use it properly. Jeffrey talked about Carol Tenopi earlier, and I have another survey from her, which is the value of the perceived value of the library. The library as perceived value of the library as a gateway is falling. Carol published a rather large report last year where she's been going both in US libraries and between US researchers and making elaborate research into where they were getting, asking them where they were getting the material and seeing who they were thanking and that kind of stuff. And it was very obvious that the library and the material from the library was getting less and less space, both in their minds and in their material. So, she quite simply said that the perception of the library is falling, but the money is spent on libraries is growing. It's spent through DISC, it's spent on individual library budgets, it's all over the place, but at the same time, the users don't recognize the library. So that is slightly, that's not so good. So, and now comes sort of the more, what I'm doing. Some years back, we were a few researchers, or we were a few people within ProQuest, as it was then, who was in something called an incubation tank. We were asked what would the most amazing thing you could imagine. Think of the most fanciful things. And we got a project together saying, okay, what if we could search everything on one level? We could search books, we could search articles, we could search images, we could search data, we could search anything within the one Google, like a Google Scholar, but not a Google Scholar, because the problem with Google Scholar is, of course, that you can't limit it. Google Scholar is everything, and you have no management of what it searches. You have no control of if it searches within your own collections or if it searches everything else. And you don't really know the quality of what's in there, but it's good, but it's missing things also. So what if we made something which was a bit more manageable, a bit more controllable by the libraries, and actually had the metadata indexed in a better way than Google Scholar is doing? Because of course Google Scholar is basically just crawling it, which is fine if the data is tagged, but in a lot of cases it isn't. So we came up with this idea of web scale discovery 3 years ago, and we've had a lot of fun building a huge Google-like database since. It's been really exciting. And we've had a lot of pains because metadata and data is not easy to play with. It's very far from easy. We had some perceptions of what we wanted in there when we sort of made the project. We wanted it preloaded so it's fast. Of course, as I said earlier, we want all the content. We wanted granularity. Not just so we just searched on what is usually available, but also on what is within the articles. What is within the images, what is within the graphs, like search, being actually able to search on figures, search on DNA sequences. It's difficult. Because then we get to what is the data set and what is the quality of the data set, but I'll get to that. And then the normalized data, which is another major, as everybody who's ever been working or worked with a cataloging department will know that data is a variety of things, and the more granular you want it, the more data you need to put in, and not everything, unfortunately, is tagged within the material that you're getting, so there's a lot of manual work there. So, sort of a normal data process within this is that you have an article. If you say sort of the article is sort of the basic research output. That's what the researcher as an author puts out, but there's stuff behind it, and also the article is very often having several instances with several bits of metadata in it. The article itself, say a Nature article, comes with a full text, which has, thanks to Nature, some tags in it, which is very nice. It doesn't have a lot of abstract, it doesn't have a lot of keywords, but it's there and it's great. Then you can get other bits for that piece of metadata and snag it on like an abstract or mesh from Medline, other bits and pieces. So it sort of gets in. What could be interesting, getting away from the article, is also see what is around, what is in the cloud around the article. And that's why I put the data sets on there. What is in the cloud around the article? What sort of stuff has the author been using to make this article? We're very clear on what you were saying, that it's not that easy to get the data sets behind the articles. And I certainly hope that one of my reasons for coming here today is that I hope that some of the people talking about data sets, maybe we can work together and see what kind of project you can make to make it more discoverable along with the articles. The problem being that data sets in the raw, as Michael also was saying, might not be that valuable, because data sets just being found out in, they need to have some sort of peer review, perhaps, and peer review maybe in the article. They need to have some sort of provenance, because not all data out there are good data. We all know that we can make wrong measurements. There's lots of data that's not being out in the repositories, out in the data sets, that's not being used, because they are not correct. They're not very well made. So how to distinguish between the ones that you actually want other people to use and the ones that it's actually better left to die? And I was very much listening to your talk, because it's very much one of our discussions as well, that how to get the right data sets in and how to get them reviewed. I was disappointed that Technische Universität from Hannover was not coming today, because I know they've done quite a lot of work on putting DOIs on data sets, which is quite interesting. And I think they're also working on sort of putting a bit of a peer review on them. So to finish this, this is how it's working right now, apart from the data sets. The way they are using the we're making the metadata, we're working with the metadata within the web scale discovery that I'm working with. And the interesting part is then to get back to the users. Are the users actually using it? Are the users happy about what we're doing? Because now we've created, it's a year old, we've created this web Google for libraries. And the question is, can the users use it? Are they happy about it, or are they disappointed? It's live in quite a few libraries, and we've got some usage data from the libraries, again, to get back to the users, because I think the proof in the pudding for the users is, for a product, is if it's been used. And it's quite interesting to see that the library usage is changing quite significantly with a web scale discovery. The way the users use the library. Suddenly the abstracting and indexing databases, this library has started having it in September, December. This is before and this is after. So there is a distinct difference in the way people are searching, because well, I'd rather use it. This is the link resolver click-throughs. And you can see the link resolver click-throughs is significantly up. Suddenly people are starting, the students are starting, the users are starting to use the resources that it's subscribed to. And you can see it's quite significant improvement in usage of the articles and of the databases subscribed to. So the question is, if some sort of indexing, it's of course also indexing the institutional repositories. And I haven't got figures for the change in use there, because institutional repositories is very often a big pain for the institutions to get them used. And suddenly, it's very interesting. We haven't got, not many of them actually have statistics on them, so we haven't been able to get statistics. But quite a few of them experience sudden peaks in usage now that they hadn't had before, like particular documents, digitized document of the building of the Oklahoma Railroad. You wouldn't think that had a huge interest outside Oklahoma. But there was actually a French library that found it through this summon discovery. And now is like this French researcher who's writing all the time to the people in Oklahoma saying he's so happy about it because it actually saved him the trip to Oklahoma because he has access to the full documentations on the net and he found it through this service, which is quite amazing. And it really shows that when you have repositories, they also need to have sort of a common discovery tool. There's more user statistics. It's kind of interesting because it shows that the huge increases usually are to resources that haven't been used, haven't been known very much before, or has had very, very difficult interfaces. I don't know how many of you have used LexisNexis. And it's not there. But it's one of them who has the highest improvement in use through this because the interface is so awful that most users can't figure out how to use it. And suddenly they can because there's a different search interface. So I think it could, all these data are, by the way, from, as you can see, from Grand Valley State University, who's done a lot of research on the uses, the change in usage. I hope we can have a discussion about inclusion of data sets and also about how to validate the data sets, because it could be really interesting to get a controlled test into someone. I'd really be interested in working with whoever would like to do that, to get a controlled body, and also where we can see usage changes, usage statistics, so we can see if it's being used and how it's being used, because then only then it becomes really interesting. It's not interesting if it's just being used as figures to be thrown into some report, but it would be interesting to see if it's used in a constructive way and if the data is being shared. So I think I'm probably short of time, but
Will you be here the rest of
yes,
the day?
Yes, I will.
Good, because what I'd like to do is very much, if Adam could come, we won't have questions now because I want to get a little bit nearer to time than we were, and if Adam can come along. But thank you very much indeed.